Welcome to this session dedicated to measurement and mismeasurement issues. Unfortunately, mismeasurement always comes along with measurement. My name is Jean-Luc Tavernière. I'm head of INSEE, the French National Statistical Office. And well, the title of the session is Welfare, Measure and Mismeasure, and could have been Welfare and GDP, Measure and Mismeasure. It's an old story, as a matter of fact, as old as the national accounts themselves, I think. It's since the very, very beginning of national accounts that discussions, heavy discussions, have existed about what GNP or GDP really measure, about the poor proxy of welfare they are. It's not only an academic debate. From time to time, it can turn to a more open and public debate. Think about the Stiglitz-Sen Fitoussi Commission about 10 years ago. Another big issue is the permanent one, is the reliability of a breakdown between quantities and prices. It's not new either. Just remember the Boskin Commission in the US in the 90s. For the time being, the increasing concern about these two issues has, in my view, two new drivers. The first one is the conundrum of a global productivity slowdown, and hence the debate about secular stagnation. Since we don't have any easy and consensual economic explanation, it's worth asking whether the TFP slowdown could be a pure statistical artifact. The second driver is about digitalization. Does it challenge the relevancy of our traditional statistical instruments to measure added value? Does it increase the discrepancy between GDP and welfare? As you may remember, the conference of last year ended with this kind of questions, Philippe, since Philippe Aguillon argued in his presidential address that economic growth was possibly underestimated in France, as in many other countries, due to an insufficient consideration of the creative destruction process in the price statistics of statistical offices. As the head of INSEE, of course, I worry about this, and I'm glad to chair this session. And to come back to the issue and to foster the dialogue between producers of statistics and users. Economists, indeed, had been very active during the initial elaboration of national accounts until the 50s, especially in France. Seeing economists interested in measurement issues is rather good news for statisticians, although it's challenging. Economists still have an utmost important role to play to tell whether statistics and national accounts fulfill their needs, and by the way, the needs of the policymakers, and what can be possibly improved. It is this kind of dialogue between producers and users that we should try to have in the next 90 minutes with our five eminent speakers. First of all, I'll come back to you later, Didier. First of all, I thank Philippe for having accepted to come back for some after sales service of his last presidential address last year. I don't think it's necessary to recall who is Philippe for the IFS audience. Everybody knows he has been professor of economics at Harvard from 2002 to 2015. And you are, since 2015, you have been at the same time professor at the London School of Economics and holder of a chair, Economics of Institutions, Innovation and Growth at the Collège de France. You do a lot of things at the same time, as a matter of fact, Philippe. And en même temps, sounds good to you, I know. We all know that most of his work has been devoted to the analysis of economic growth and his interest for these mismeasurement issues. The following speaker will be Diane Cole. She's currently professor at the University of Cambridge, author of several books, including, I love the title, GDP, A Brief and Affectionate History. That's right. Published in 2014. And probably many people have also had the occasion to read some of your chronicles in the Financial Times. Among your several activities, I noted that you are a fellow of the Office for National Statistics of the British INSEE. You are lead investigator in a project on measurement issues in the modern economy. If I understand correctly, this project has been created at the ONS following recommendations of Sir Charles Bean, a review of UK economic statistics with a particular emphasis on these measurement issues. Andrew Clark will be next. Not necessary to introduce you in this building, Andrew, since you used to be co-director of one of the PSC programs, the labor program. Many activities, of course, but I will mention that you are co-director of the CEPREMAP Wellbeing Observatory, an observatory that has some links with INSEE. You use our survey, monthly survey, about households' economic perception. And subjective well-being is indeed your main research field, and you just published a book whose title is The Origins of Happiness, not least. Last, Paul Schreier. He has been at the OECD Secretariat since 1988. And you are, Paul, now currently Deputy Chief Statistician. You have covered for many years all the fields related to national countings, measurement of capital and productivity, measurement of non-market activity, price statistics, and so on and so on. You were one of the rapporteurs of the Stiglitz and Fitoussi Commission, and you have been heavily involved in all what has been done at the OECD following this report, including green growth indicators and the measurement of well-being, of course. But before your four interventions, I will let the floor to Didier Blanchet for some remarks. Didier did a lot to organize the session, and he will help us in this introductory remarks to structure the rest of the debate. Didier is currently the head of the National Accounts and Economics Emphasis Directorate at INSEE. As Paul, he has been one of the rapporteurs of Stiglitz and so on commission. And maybe, Didier, you will insist in what is new and what is not new in the current debate compared to the situation that motivated the Stiglitz and Fitoussi commission about 10 years ago. I will let you about 10 minutes for everyone. It will give you the opportunity to react to one another, and if we stick to the timetable, to have some space, some room for Q&A with the audience afterwards. Didier, you have the floor.
Okay, so good afternoon, everybody, and thanks to the EFSA for the invitation to have this roundtable. As announced by Jean-Luc, I will try to give a few elements of context for this about this mismeasurement issue. I'm going to make four remarks that will lead to four questions to be shared with other people around the table. My first point is going to say that we do not have one, but at least two mismeasurement debates. We have the position that I'm going to call today MM1, according to which national accounts are poorly capturing the new forms taken by economic growth, especially those forms allowed by digitalization. So the view here is the fact that national accounts underestimate the real rate of economic growth, and so Philippe Aguillon is going to be representative here of this view. In a moment, he's going to give his estimate of this underestimation. It may be up to 0.5, 0.8 yearly points of growth, which is, if correct, is not, of course, not negligible at all. But we need also to recall that national accountants have been used to face a completely opposite criticism. The fact that GDP is something far too optimistic about the way things are improving for the population because it neglects things such as environmental externalities or rising inequalities. This is now a hot topic, of course. This is a literature that goes back to the 1970s. I just chose to illustrate the message of this MM2 current by providing here the graph of one of the many alternative indicators that have been proposed to correct these problems with GDP. This one is called Genuine Progress Indicator. It is something that has been created in the 1980s, I think, and it is regularly updated. Here it is data for a set of 17 countries. I do not mean to suggest that this indicator is what we should do and it is better than other ones, but I use it just to show how far can be the distance between the kind of message given by Philippe and the kind of message given by these other category of criticisms of GDP, because here you have in blue or in purple, an indicator that in fact has completely stopped growing since the mid-1970s, and you have in green the evolution of the GDP for these 17 countries. So we can say that in a sense, national accountants, they are caught between two files. Those people who say that GDP is underestimating real growth is a new form of criticism, and this older criticism that GDP is something that strongly overestimates the way things are improving for the population. So my second point is going to be to recall how national accountants try to do with these two opposite criticisms. Their traditional answer to MM2 is relatively easy. They recall that, in fact, the question should have been completely cleared already in the 1950s. There had been some big debates at this time about knowing whether GDP was going to measure something close to well-being, and the answer was definitely no. And so the problem with MM2 is only that we have some people thinking that GDP should measure the evolution of this well-being. GDP doesn't measure that. It just measures production, and more specifically, one specific segment of production, the one that has some monetary counterparts. Measuring well-being and its sustainability, of course, is a very important topic, but you need for that some other stuff. National accounts can provide some part of the material that you need to assess well-being and its sustainability, but you have to move also to other material to build a complete picture, and this is more a topic for research than a topic for ordinary statistical production. The answer to MM1 here, the problem is maybe in principle more difficult for them because here we have a criticism that directly address the capacity of GDP to go on measuring what it had been designed to measure, that is to say production. So what is the answer of national accountants on this MM1 criticism? In fact, there are two aspects in this criticism. There is the fact that to know whether the boundaries of GDP as they are currently defined are still adequate, especially in a world where thanks to the internet, you have several things that are now available for free while you had to pay for them before. Here, the dominant answer by national accountants is to say, well, we have some good reason to stick to this monetary domain because of some of the uses of GDP. GDP is essentially done to monitor macroeconomic policy. It is also done to compute indexes such as debt or deficit to GDP ratios. In both cases, what you are interested in is the creation of paid activity. And it is this paid activity that is going to provide the fiscal resources for governments. And so we have good reason. Maybe the emergence of some free goods is going to be so good news for all the people, but certainly not good news for the management of public finances, for instance. Then, in fact, the more narrow problem and really the crucial one for national accountants is another one, which is within these boundaries of monetary production. So we measure adequately the global flows of money between people. We have to make the divide between these values and the underlying volumes. So this is what we call volume price decomposition. And the technique we use to do that are heavily challenged by digitization and the fact that products are being, there is the renewal of products is increasingly more rapid. Here, the position of national accountants is more defensive. It is to say, well, in fact, if you look back In the past, it has been always the case that economic growth has gone through creative destruction. So the story about the internet is not necessarily that new. And maybe there is a structural problem with the estimation of the rate of growth, but the problem maybe was the same 40 years ago. And so this would mean that this problem of mismeasurement linked to digitization is not necessarily the explanation to put forward to explain the recent slowdown of productivity and production. So it's not an explanation for the famous theory about secular stagnation. I don't know how much time I have left. what I want to say, so stated in that way, the problem seems relatively clear. This is going to be my third point. The reasons why I think it is less clear than it seems to be, and why we need to discuss on that with economists. My point is that, in fact, it is the position by national accountants is to say, well, things are clear. Our job is essentially the measure of production or the measure of incomes, and you have the measure of well-being on the other side. But it's a bit more complicated than that, because when you ask two accountants, how do you measure volumes? They say we are going to aggregate quantities according to prices, and you ask them why do you use prices, and they are going to answer because they reflect relative marginal utilities. And so if this is true, then this means that what in the end they try to measure is something that is not well-being in the full sense of the term, but which has some strong connection with the notion of well-being or utility. And more specifically, you have also many things that have been progressively added to the core concept of market production that you cannot understand without considering that national accountants want to bring their own contribution to the measurement and the comparison of well-being across populations. For instance, it is the only way to understand why we introduce in the measure of production the measure of imputed rents, for instance, for people who are owning their homes. So we have a tension that we cannot deny. We know national accountants know that measuring well-being is out of reach for them. I don't know if it is possible for anybody, in fact. But they nevertheless have to go in this direction. But in doing so, they have no clear guidance about where, how far they can or should go. And I think the example of free internet services is a good example of that. We would like to take them into account, especially in view of the point that, well, we are trying to make as good as possible corrections for the introduction of new goods, which are cheaper than older ones, and to control for quality effects. But if you introduce a new free good, it is just an extreme case of a decline in prices. And so you have no reason to treat this differently. But if you say, well, so we want to reintroduce these free goods in our evaluation of economic growth, then why to stop there? If we want to reintroduce in the valuation of economic growth everything that has no price, so we are in fact facing again the MM2 criticism, and we in principle we should have to go to the complete problem of measuring full well-being. In addition, but shortly, since I have only 1 minute left, as problems never come alone, we have a new problem with GDP and the production approach to the measurement of economic progress. It's a problem with the D, the fact that production is increasingly less easy to define in a globalized world. And we have the well-known example of the very rapid increase of the Irish GDP in 2000, between 2014 and 2015, plus more than plus 25%. Within 1 year due to the relocalization of some immaterial assets of large multinational firms. In a way, I would say that this kind of problem is an additional argument to look more strongly in the direction of measuring well-being, because well-being is something that is attached to people, and people, we know where they are. So it has more sense to define domestic well-being, while defining domestic production is something that is increasingly difficult. But once again, if you enter into this problematic, then you face the problem that measuring well-being is something that is very difficult and for which we have no clear definition. So to sum up a set of questions, What is the larger problem for existing measures? Is it MM1, MM2, or MM3? What do we want? I think this is the real basic question. We cannot discuss mismeasurement without any clear definition of what we want to measure. What do we want to measure exactly? Is it just production, but what is production? Is it well-being, but how do you define well-being? Is it something in between? But in that case, where exactly in between? I think we have to try to define a position on this. Maybe it is several things that we have to measure, of course, probably. Then we have the problem of instruments. Here, this is more for Andrew, but in particular, the question of how we can use data on subjective well-being in order to feed the debate. And also, this is an open question for the room. National accountants cannot do everything alone. So I think here we have a domain where collaboration, more instant collaboration, more intensive collaboration would be welcome between producers of statistics and academics. That's all for me. Thank you.